Good morning and welcome to worship here at First Baptist Church of Pendleton on this first Sunday of May, the first day of May, and the third Sunday of Easter. We are continuing in the Easter season, celebrating the resurrection of Christ. Unfortunately, our Minister of Music and Youth is not with us again this week. You may remember he was on vacation last week, and then when he came home, discovered that he had contracted COVID, and so he is not able to be with us. He is doing better. Symptoms were mild and seemed to have subsided, so we are thankful for that, but we continue to hold Chris in our prayers and hope that he will be able to be back with us soon. I'm also thankful to our choir and to Richard for their leadership and stepping up, and I believe John is helping with directing. Yes, that works. Yes, leading from the choir, that works. So thank you all for stepping in, and what a gift to have a choir anthem today, even in the absence of our music minister, and that speaks to the leadership of others within the church, within the choir, and our organist. So we are thankful for them, their willingness, and using those gifts. This morning, we will be reflecting on the passage where Jesus encounters the disciples on the beach after his resurrection. So we continue in those post-resurrection appearances, reflecting on what does it mean to follow Jesus after Easter? How do we follow Jesus? How do we follow the risen Christ? So as we enter into worship today, let me invite you to join us in prayer. God, we thank you for your powerful presence with us through all things, through difficult times and through times of joy. And God, as we reflect on our journey to follow you, we pray that you would help us to sense your presence in a near and powerful way this very moment. In these moments of worship, whether we are here in the sanctuary or joining via technology, we know, God, that you are with us wherever we are, and we pray that you would continue to lead and guide us as we seek to follow you. May we experience your presence, and may your presence strengthen us, inspire us, encourage us, and fill us with your love and grace that we might share with others. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. I may be forgiven double duty from back here in the choir loft, we'll stand and sing hymn number 295, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
This post-resurrection story comes from the concluding chapter of John, chapter 21, the first 19 verses. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, I'm going fishing. They said to him, we'll go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, children, you have no fish, have you? They answered him, no. He said to them, cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some. So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it's the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes for he was naked and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging a net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish in it, on it, and bread. Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you have just caught. So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. Now none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? Because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and go over wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hand and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, "Follow me." The word of God for the people of God.
Right. Good morning. We heard a Bible story about Jesus' disciples going fishing. So I want to show you my bowl of fish. Goldfish. Yeah, I didn't bring real fish. So here's a question for you. How many gold? You wish I did. How many goldfish do you think are in this bowl? One less now. How many goldfish? Guess the number.
Oh. Two less.
Three less. How many do you think there were in this bowl? All right, sit down for me. Sit down for me. Guess the number. How many do you think?
22,001.
How did you know that? Caleb is less than 22,001, and Thomas said 153. That's exactly right. You were listening. I'm going to read you the Bible verse about it. That's right. All right, listen, I'll let you have some in a minute, but let's not do it right now because I don't want to get crumbs all over the sanctuary. All right, can you sit down for me, Caleb, so I can read you this verse? Okay, yeah, there's less and less. All right, so here's what the Bible says. Hold on. Wait, stop. Please wait. Thank you. All right, so here's the verse. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish. How many? 153 of them. So in the Bible story, they caught no fish all night, and then Jesus came, and they caught 153 fish. And that's how many goldfish used to be in this bowl. Now there's 148, I think. But that's still a lot, right? Can you imagine that many real big fish in a boat? Yeah, and you're right, Thomas. That's the power of Jesus. So first they had nothing, and then they had a lot. Has that ever happened to you where you had nothing, and then you had a lot?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, you used to have not many Lego sets, and now you have a lot. Yeah, I think about a really dry summer day where there's no water and the ground is dusty, and then it rains, and there's puddles everywhere. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Yeah, like an empty window and then all those pieces of broken glass that make a beautiful picture. Yeah. And just like Thomas said, that's the power of Jesus, that Jesus gives us enough of what we need. Okay? Mm-hmm.
Also, when
Right. Yes. So we're going to pray, okay? Dear God, thank you that you give us enough, and thank you for the story about the fish. Amen. Take this with you to your class.
Our hymn is Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us, page 405 in your hymnal. Shall we stand and sing?
Heavenly Father, thank you for the grace that sustains us through every life experience. Thank you for the comforting assurance of your presence with us, for giving us the capacity to love, for reason and insight and opportunities for worship, for prayer and reflection on the bounty of your goodness. Lead us to be as Christ to one another, and to share generously the gifts you provide remembering always the abundance of your love for us. Bless these, our offerings, that they may be used in accordance with your will, caring for the ministry of this church, so the light of Christ should shine brightly from this very place. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray.
What beautiful words, reminding us of our commitment as disciples of Jesus. I will follow thee, my Savior, lead on, my shepherd, lead on. May that be our commitment, as the choir has so beautifully sung that expression of faith for us this day. As we reflect on the story of Jesus and the disciples beside the sea after Jesus' resurrection, I want to ask, have you ever found yourself saying, "This is not what I signed up for"? Perhaps a job description included that famous phrase, "other duties as assigned." And then when you got into it, those other duties turned out to be a lot more extensive than you had expected. Or perhaps you volunteered to help with something and it was not at all what you anticipated. Or perhaps you have found yourself surprised at times by just how challenging marriage or parenting or grandparenting can be. You may have said, "This is not what I signed up for." I wonder if that is what Peter is thinking early that morning on the beach. In John chapter 21, we find this post-resurrection account of Jesus and his disciples in a place that is familiar to them, on the water with a boat. In fact, according to the other three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, this is where Peter was first called to be a disciple. Jesus called him out of the fishing boat, saying, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Now, the Gospel of John does not include that story earlier in the Gospel, but John does tell us about Jesus calling Peter from a fishing boat after Jesus' resurrection here in John 21. The previous chapter of John, chapter 20, Jesus appeared to his disciples twice after his resurrection. First, on the evening of his resurrection, on that very evening, and then again a week later, this time with Thomas present, because Thomas had missed the first appearance and would not believe unless he saw Jesus for himself. And then at the end of chapter 20, after these two post-resurrection appearances of Jesus, it seems like John is wrapping things up. The last two verses of chapter 20 say, "Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name." Now, this sounds like it could be the end of the gospel account, this call to believe, this reminder that there are more stories. But then John adds one more chapter, chapter 21, where we find the passage that we read this morning. Some biblical scholars believe that this passage was added later and that the gospel did originally end with chapter 20. I remember the first sermon that I preached in preaching class in seminary, and everyone had a evaluation sheet that they would fill out, and then afterwards everyone would give it to you and you would read through what your classmates said about your sermon. And I remember someone said, "It felt like you were going to end several times before you actually did." And as I looked back over my sermon, I realized I did have two or three conclusions that could have concluded. I feel like that's a little bit like what John is doing. He could have concluded in chapter 20, but then there's another story he wants to tell, a little bit more about the post-resurrection Jesus. Perhaps like many novice preachers, John just didn't quite know how to end his story, and so he keeps going. Now, it is good for us that he did, because that is how we have this final chapter where we have this powerful moment between Jesus and Peter. Remember, the last time that we saw Peter in the Gospel of John was the night of Jesus' arrest. He probably was there when Jesus appeared to the disciples in those post-resurrection accounts in chapter 20, but he isn't mentioned by name. There's no interaction between Peter and Jesus. So he may have been there, but he isn't mentioned. The last time he's mentioned is back in John chapter 18, where he is standing by a fire warming himself, and he denies three times that he knows Jesus. And now in John 21, Peter is eager to jump out of the boat to get to the shore when he realizes it is Jesus. He has gone from saying, "Who? Jesus? I don't know him," to dropping what he's doing, jumping into the water to get to Jesus as quickly as he can, because he certainly does know Jesus. And at this point, is glad for anyone to know it. Once again, Peter stands by a charcoal fire. And once again, Peter is asked three times a question about his relationship with Jesus. This time, the questions come from Jesus himself. "Peter, do you love me?" Imagine a time when you have failed someone you loved. They needed something from you and you simply couldn't or weren't able to or didn't do what they needed you to do. And that is where Peter is this morning on the beach. He didn't mean to deny Jesus. He didn't want to deny Jesus. The words just sort of came out before he could stop them. And then, of course, it was too late. He couldn't take them back. Of course he loves Jesus. And Jesus knows he loves him. And so Peter is hurt when Jesus keeps asking him. Three times, Jesus asks Peter, "Do you love me?" And three times, Peter answers, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And each time, Jesus gives Peter a command. First, feed my lambs. And then, tend my sheep. And finally, feed my sheep. It's interesting that the wording is slightly different, but the idea is consistent. Peter is to take care of and provide for those who follow Jesus. Earlier in John, Jesus calls himself the Good Shepherd. And now the Good Shepherd is entrusting his sheep to Peter. Jesus is passing Peter the shepherd's staff. Staff was too long to keep up here throughout the service, so I had to hide it over there. The shepherd's staff reminds us of the work of the shepherd, the work of tending the sheep, perhaps pulling them back if needed, using it as a walking stick if needed, using the shepherd's staff to take care of the sheep. And in many ways, Jesus is passing this staff to Peter, saying, "Peter, tend my sheep." Jesus is the good shepherd, and he has been tending the sheep, but now Jesus is not going to be here anymore. And Jesus says to Peter, "If you really love me, if you really do want to be a part of what I'm doing and what I've been doing, here's your staff. Feed my lambs, tend my sheep, feed my sheep." Peter is a fisherman. What does he know about tending sheep? He's a pretty good fisherman. He just netted a pretty impressive catch of fish, of course, with Jesus' help. John tells us they caught 153 large fish. But now, Jesus is calling Peter to something completely new. Peter may have said, or at least thought, "This is not what I signed up for. You said I was going to fish for people, not tend sheep. Fishing I can do. Fishing I know about. But tending sheep, feeding lambs, that's a whole different thing. You have to keep those animals alive. You have to think about their needs. You have to keep up with them day after day. I didn't know that following Jesus meant I was going to be a shepherd." Perhaps we have had similar revelations about following Jesus. How would you finish that sentence? "I didn't know that following Jesus was going to mean blank." In what way has following Jesus surprised you? "I didn't know that following Jesus was going to mean..." was going to mean I was going to knock the microphone over. "I didn't know following Jesus was going to mean I was going to be asked to give or to do or to serve in some way. What has following Jesus meant that has surprised you? What have you been called to do that you did not sign up for?" I would venture to guess that in whatever ways we have been surprised by Jesus' call, we have also been surprised by God's provisions of whatever it was that we needed to answer that call. Remember how Peter, the experienced fisherman, caught nothing all night until Jesus showed up. And then the catch was abundant, 153 large fish, so large that the gospel writer feels the need to point out the nets didn't break. It seems it must have been large enough to break the nets, but they did not break. Jesus tells Peter, "Feed my sheep." Jesus has already given Peter what he will need to do that. And Jesus tells Peter again at the end of verse 19 what it is. Follow me. All Peter needs to do to tend the sheep of Jesus is to follow Jesus, his own shepherd. Peter has in Jesus a good shepherd, and as he follows Jesus, Jesus will show Peter how to take care of the sheep, how to be a shepherd, how to be a good shepherd like Jesus. And friends, this is true for us as well. Whatever Jesus is calling us to do, however Jesus is calling us to serve and to give and to love and to make a difference in the world, Jesus has given us what we need to answer that call. What we need is a shepherd, and we have that shepherd in Jesus, our good shepherd. And so when we follow our good shepherd, he will show us what he calls us to do. Just as the choir sang, "I will follow, lead on, shepherd, lead on." All we have to do is follow. And that is true for us as individuals and as a church, as a community. Jesus will never leave us alone. We have a good shepherd. And when we follow our shepherd, we too can take care of the sheep Jesus has called us to tend. Just as Jesus passed the shepherd's staff to Peter, Jesus is passing it to us. I want you to imagine what it would mean for you to take this shepherd's staff. How is Jesus calling you to take this staff and tend the sheep, to care for the sheep of Jesus? How is Jesus inviting us to answer this call? Jesus said, "Feed my lambs. Tend my sheep. Feed my sheep." Now notice what Jesus does not say. He does not say, "Count my sheep." Sometimes, especially as a church, we can get caught up in how many sheep are here, how many do we have, and we worry about that. Jesus said, "Tend my sheep. Just take care of the people who are here." Jesus does not say, "Choose which sheep you want." We don't get to decide which sheep are part of the flock. Jesus said, "I have other sheep that are not of this flock, and I will bring them also." Jesus also doesn't say, "Convince the sheep to follow me." And Jesus doesn't say, "Figure out which ones are truly my sheep." Jesus simply says, "Feed my sheep. Tend my sheep. Feed my lambs, the most vulnerable of the sheep." Sometimes we get caught up in who's doing what and who, what we are supposed to do. Perhaps sometimes we need to just go back to this simple instruction. When we find ourselves uncertain of what direction to go, unsure of how to faithfully respond to the challenges of our day, perhaps there is clarity for us in this simple command: feed my sheep. What can we do to feed the sheep that Jesus has entrusted to us? This church has and is feeding sheep well in so many ways. If you look in your bulletin, you see evidence of a number of these. We have a barrel in the hallway for food for Clemson Community Care. And in your bulletin, there's a list of the current needs for Clemson Community Care. And people are always bringing food to put in the barrel. And when it's full, they come and get it and distribute it to people in need. This is a way that we are quite literally feeding sheep, feeding people in our community. We also offer space in our church to our community. You see this in our bulletin as well. I was just noticing, especially on Tuesday of this week, we will have Project Hope here. They're here every day during the week providing therapy and education to children with autism. And then on Tuesday, we have a multiple sclerosis support group, we have a Girl Scout troop, and we have the National Alliance for Mental Illness meeting, all happening on Tuesday in our building. Four different community groups for four very different groups happening in our building, because this is the way we are tending the sheep of the community, taking care of people, taking care of needs, all different kinds of needs. We have offered online worship to take care of the sheep of our flock and of other flocks, because during the last few years, a couple of years, it has not been safe to gather in person. And even now, as many of us are returning, there are some who are still not comfortable returning, who have health conditions that make it difficult for them to return, people whose doctors are saying, don't be around people if at all possible. And we have invested significant resources to have online worship. Just a couple of weeks ago, we concluded our capital campaign that we started last year. And in a year when there was much uncertainty, including financial uncertainty, we contributed nearly $60,000 to provide the online worship resources, to do some HVAC repairs and some other things in our building. We invested this because it's a way of tending the sheep. We're offering online worship. We're taking care of our building so we have the space for people to come. This is how we tend the sheep Jesus has entrusted to us. We also, a couple of months ago, adopted an inclusivity statement to be specific about who we are as a church, that we want to welcome everybody. All who want to follow Jesus are welcome here. And that's a way of saying we're not going to pick out which sheep are really Jesus' sheep. We're going to leave that between them and the good shepherd. Our job is to tend the sheep, which is what Jesus told Peter. Certainly there are times for teaching and encouraging and instructing, but what Jesus tells Peter here in these important moments on the beach, when Peter is kind of being invited back into the fold, Peter is the one who has strayed away. He denied Jesus, and Peter is reminding Jesus, there's still a place for you here if you want it. Do you love me? And when Peter says yes, Jesus says, tend my sheep. So friends, that is the invitation for us. Do you love Jesus? No matter what we have done in the past, no matter how we have fallen short, no matter how we have denied Jesus, do you love me? Jesus says. And if the answer is yes, then tend my sheep. And that is what we are here to do, to tend the sheep that Jesus has entrusted to us. Let us pray together. Jesus, our good shepherd, we thank you for taking care of us, for providing for our needs. And we thank you for the ways in which we can help take care of others. God, you have entrusted us with this tremendous task, with this challenge of tending your sheep. You remind us that you are the good shepherd, that your sheep listen to your voice, and that your sheep come from all different flocks. I have other sheep that are not of this flock, you told us. And God, help us to tend the sheep you entrust to us. Remind us that you are a good shepherd for all who follow you. Help us to follow you faithfully as your sheep and as shepherds, for you have called us to join you in this task of tending the sheep. Grant us wisdom and courage and patience and love and all that we will need to tend your sheep. And we ask this, God, knowing that you have already answered this prayer. You have already granted to us all that we will need, which is a good shepherd. And so we pray to you, our good shepherd, thanking you that you are good, that you lead us. And so we pray in the words of the anthem, Jesus, we follow you. Lead on, good shepherd, lead on. Amen. Our hymn of response this morning is My Faith Looks Up to Thee, hymn number 407. And as we sing our hymn of response, I'll be here at the altar table. I'm going to take the shepherd's staff with me to remind us we are called to be shepherds. We are called to tend sheep that Jesus has entrusted to us. And during this time of response, let me encourage you to reflect on perhaps there's a way Jesus is calling you to respond today, to tend sheep as Jesus is calling you. Perhaps that involves making a decision public here in our congregation. Perhaps it involves making a decision there quietly in your pew between you and the Good Shepherd. How is Jesus calling you to tend his sheep? And let us follow and faithfully answer that call as we sing together hymn 407, My Faith Looks Up to Thee.
Let me invite you to be seated for just a moment. I have mentioned already our bulletin and the announcement insert. And if you're joining us online, it is available on our website, fbcpendleton.org. But I wanted to mention a couple of things that are coming up. We are starting a new Wednesday night Bible study this week on the theme of Believe. And we'll be meeting here at the church in person at 6:30 and also on Zoom. So you're welcome to join us either way. It is based on one of the verses I mentioned this morning, but these are written so that you will believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you will have life in his name. So we'll be reflecting on what it means to believe in Jesus. And can you believe and doubt at the same time? And how do we believe in difficult times? And how has the church believed throughout history? So we'll be reflecting on that theme of believe through our Wednesday night Bible study during the month of May. Since today is the first day of May, I left it up here. We have a new devotional book. The Reflection devotional book starts with May. And so if you'd like to pick up one of these, they're available on the table outside the office if you go right through these doors. This is a devotional, daily devotional guide that starts today. So you are right on track to start that. We'll have Wednesday night supper this week, our regular schedule. And the Mother's Day Parade, the Pendleton Community Mother's Day Parade, will be next Saturday. We have some volunteers who are putting together a church float for us. So if you would like to participate in the Mother's Day Parade or just come watch the Mother's Day Parade, it will be next Saturday afternoon. Richard, anything else we need to say about that? Okay, so if you'd like to help decorate, we'll be meeting here at the church an hour, a little more before the parade starts. You can touch base with Richard for details as we participate in this community event. This is a great way to be a part of our community. Speaking of community, we are ordering t-shirts that we can wear in the community to let folks know who we are when we do events like this. They won't be here in time for the parade, but they should be here for the next thing. So if you'd like a First Baptist Church of Pendleton t-shirt, you can go online and order one. They're $15. You can also request one. There's a form on the table outside the office. If you'd like to not have to do it online, you can just fill out the form there. And then we will have some extra shirts. We're going to provide shirts for children and youth. And then if anyone else needs one, we can certainly provide that. But we're asking for a donation of $15 if you can to help cover the costs and also to help cover the costs for children and youth. I think that is it. Any other announcements? Yes. Yes, thank you. Wanted to mention as well that one of our church members, Tommy Johnson, has passed away on Wednesday, I believe it was, of this past week. The funeral will be this coming Wednesday. The family is still finalizing arrangements, so I'm not sure all the details, but we will send that out by email. Tommy Johnson, you may remember Tommy and Debbie Johnson. They had two children, Jeremy and Amanda, so you may remember their family. But Tommy Johnson has passed away, and we'll have his memorial service this coming Wednesday. Thank you for reminding me to mention that. Let me invite you to hear this word of benediction, a benediction that reminds us of our good shepherd. This benediction comes from Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 through 21. May the God of peace, who brought back the great shepherd of the sheep, our Lord Jesus, from the dead by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with every good thing to do his will, by developing in us what pleases him through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory forever and always. Amen.